Hello friends, so I'll be talking on this topic, how to prevent lung injury in COVID. So this talk I gave it to Patna, Indian Society of Critical Care Medicine chapter 2 days back. So that is on 18th of December 2020. So when this topic was given to me, I was trying to see how to address this topic, preventing lung injury. So the way I thought should this topic should be approached is, so we have to look at COVID as a spectrum, as a disease spectrum, which is a progressive condition from the onset. So obviously at the onset they may be asymptomatic and then they go on to needing oxygen. So this is when we understand that lung is getting involved, and after maybe nasal prongs they may go to face mask and then they may continue to progress to non-rebreathing, and maybe then they would continue to progress if we do not intervene at any of these stages to needing NIV or HFNC, and if they don't respond well to these measures then they would end up going on a ventilator, ECMO and death. So this is the typical spectrum of COVID that we see, and we need to determine what all interventions need to be put in place at different intervals to prevent the lung injury, because once someone has gone on oxygen, it means lung injury has set in, and then the lung injury perpetuates and continues to worsen if no intervention is put in place. So the way I looked at it is interventions at different time frames to prevent further progression, and we understand why this happens. So when the COVID initially affects an individual, so the first phase, as soon as it affects, the predominant pathophysiology that happens is extensive viral replication. So once there is an extensive viral replication and exponential increase, the body's immune response would have triggered, but it would not have overwhelmingly increased to lead to a cytokine storm. But once patient continues to deteriorate, where lungs get affected, then the immune response or the cytokine storm becomes very violent, and it overwhelms and it supersedes your viral replication phase, and this is the situation where lungs is profoundly affected and other organ dysfunctions would have set in. So we need to understand this sort of a timelines, because when we see someone who is needing oxygen or who is on NIV, it means your whole cytokine system or your immune system is hyperactivated and there is overwhelming sort of a cytokine response at this stage. So we have different interventions to address these issues at different timelines. So even if you look at all the studies so far in COVID, so the studies have factored in these time intervals. So if you look at any remdesivir studies or steroid studies, they look at these time frames as an ordinal scale. So ordinal scale of 5 is when patients are needing oxygen. And this is the group of patients where there has been profound emphasis in all the studies as to how interventions have changed outcomes in this group of patients. And ordinal scale 6 is where someone is needing NIV. Ordinal scale 7 is where someone needs intubation and mechanical ventilation. Ordinal scale 8 is death. And before ordinal scale 5, where patients are hospitalized for ongoing treatment, it would be ordinal scale 4. So this is the scale that globally we have accepted, and all the studies are addressing as to how interventions are helping them for patients to not progress from one score to worsening score. So the way I would look at it is, from onset to someone needing oxygen, the predominant intervention that would help prevention of lung injury is use of remdesivir in this phase. And once they go on oxygen, the important aspect that is shown to prevent further progression of lung injury is use of steroids. And along with steroids, we have understood the pathophysiology of COVID is a little different, in that hypoxia is set in with lung injury along with microthrombi formation. So use of anticoagulation or venous thromboembolic prophylaxis. And once they go on NIV and ventilator, then you have to adopt ventilatory strategies to prevent further perpetuation of lung injury. So these are the sort of interventions that we could adopt to prevent the lung injury at different intervals. Okay. So now I would just take you through the evidence for these interventions and whether we are justified in using these interventions at these timely intervals. So I'll take you through only key articles for the evidence of remdesivir in preventing lung injury. So this was an important trial that came in May 2020 in NEJM, where they basically looked at whether 5 days remdesivir is good enough or 10 days remdesivir should be given. So the important finding in this particular study, where they did a subgroup analysis in 237 patients who were on mechanical ventilator or on who are ECMO, where it showed remdesivir given for 5 days, the mortality in mechanical ventilator was 40%. But in the group where remdesivir was given for 10 days, the mortality was significantly less, which means to say in the sickest of the patient, using remdesivir for 10 days saved lives. That's what this subgroup analysis in this study showed. And this is something that one could keep in mind in severe cases. But if someone is on NIV or HFNO, the day 14 death, there was no difference between remdesivir for 5 days or 10 days. So because of this study, many state guidelines have adopted usage of remdesivir only for 5 days because it did not show any difference in patients who are on oxygen or NIV-HFNO, but it did make a difference in someone who were very sick needing intubation and mechanical ventilation. After this particular study came in August 2020, which was conducted by Gilead, which is the company which produces remdesivir. So this was inverse propensity test weighted study where propensity matching was done in a large group of patients, comparing the baseline characteristics and matching the baseline characteristics. So they had 1,130 patients and 312 in the remdesivir group, 818 patients in the control group. So this was a large set of data in retrospect where they took matched the baselines and compared. They found the day 14 recovery was significantly better in remdesivir, 74.4%. Versus 59%, and that was significant. And they looked at day 14 mortality, which was significantly less in the remdesivir group as compared to the control group. That was also significant. So this is a graphical representation. The black one is the remdesivir group, where increased number of patients with remdesivir improved compared to the non-remdesivir. And this is the death rates, where it was significantly less compared to the non-remdesivir group. So this is the most recent trial that came on 5th November 2020, which is the ACT, which was ACT 1 study group investigators. So as you see, this is the ordinal scale. So the ordinal scale is of 4, means that patients are hospitalized, they're not needing oxygen, but they are undergoing some sort of a treatment, maybe remdesivir infusion. So they had 13% of the patients in that ordinal scale 4, but the significant proportion of the patients in this study was in ordinal scale of 5, which means patients who were needing supplemental oxygen, which was 41%. This is very important because most studies, the benefit of using remdesivir has been found to be in patients who are needing oxygen and early usage within 10 days. So if you see here, they looked at recovery rate ratio, and recovery rate ratio was largest in this group of patients who were needing supplemental oxygen, which was 1.45, and someone who was needing NIV or HFNO, 18.2% of the patients were there, 193, and you see the recovery rate ratio is lesser than the ordinal scale of 5. It was 1.29, and it starts coming down once patient becomes sicker and sicker. So once they go on ventilator, you see the recovery rate ratio is only 0.98, which means to say the greatest benefit of remdesivir was found in patients when you catch them when they start needing to oxygen and intervene and administer remdesivir within the 10 days. So that was a very important message from this trial. And as you see, they did a subgroup analysis, less than 10 days and more than 10 days. If you see, the recovery rate ratio was statistically significant when you gave remdesivir within 10 days, and this was very profound in patients who are needing oxygen. As you see the confidence interval, it is statistically significant. But if you give remdesivir after 10 days, it loses the significance because the recovery rate ratio is not statistically significant. So that is the key message from this particular ACT study, which came on August 2020. So give it less than 10 days and maximally benefit once patient goes on to needing oxygen. So this was the other results of this study. So they had 1062, 541 in the remdesivir and 521 in the placebo. So the median time to recovery was 10 days in the remdesivir and 15 days, and that was significant. And day 15 clinical improvement also was significantly better in remdesivir. That was also statistically significant. Day 15 mortality was, you see that signal towards less, but they were not statistically significant. Day 29 mortality Again, you see, it was not statistically significant. But when they only looked at the patients with ordinal scale of 5, it attained statistical significance. You see the hazard ratio 0.3 and confidence interval shows statistical significance there. And serious adverse events were little less in remdesivir. So additional secondary outcomes they found in this ACT study was they looked at the ordinal scale of 1 category improvement, which means if patients are caught in ordinal scale of 6, improving to ordinal score of 5, or if they treat patients with ordinal scale of 5, they move to ordinal scale 4. That's what we call as 1 category ordinal scale improvement. And that happened in lesser time in remdesivir as compared to the placebo. And as you see, that is statistically significant. Ordinal scale 2 category improvement, which means from 6 they move on to 4, from 7 they move on to 5. That happened in lesser time in remdesivir as compared to the placebo, and that was also statistically significant. So these are all significant. And discharge time also was less, which means the patients got in better, which means the lungs were better protected and recovery happened better, and that was found. So ACT is a very important study where a lot of outcome indicators did suggest the benefit of remdesivir and prevented further progression of lung injury. So this was the forest plot again showing. So if you see, the statistical significance typically happened in patients with ordinal scale of 5, where you see the line moving away from the point of no significance. So that becomes very significant. So that's about ACT, and this is the most recent study that came, which is looked at baricitinib plus remdesivir for hospitalized. So this came on 11 December. It's just come around few days back. So baricitinib inhibits JAK1 and JAK2 inhibitor. So it's a JNS kinase inhibitor. So the way it acts is it inhibits the intracellular signaling mechanism. So there is a lot of signaling mechanism that are mediated by these mediators called IL-2, IL-6, interferon, GCSF to activate the cytokine storm. So it is shown to inhibit that, and it also prevents the entry of virus into the cells by impairing AP2 related protein kinase. And as we very clearly know now that in COVID, lymphopenia is a very bad marker, and it is a significant prognostic marker of bad outcomes. And baricitinib is known to increase your lymphocyte count, which may be protective in nature. So the preamble for doing this randomized control was there are 3 case series from USA, Italy and Spain, which has shown use of baricitinib improved oxygen and reduced inflammatory markers. So this was a study where one arm they had remdesivir and the second arm they had remdesivir with baricitinib. So baricitinib is an anti-cancer drug. It's very expensive. So there may be limitations for us to use this baricitinib. So the dose they gave was 4 mg per day in divided 2 mg twice a day for 14 days. If creatinine clearance was less than 60 ml, they gave 2 mg once a day. So they had 1033 patients, 515 in remdesivir and baricitinib group, 518 in remdesivir group. And this was a significantly positive study favoring the beneficial effect of baricitinib. So the time to recovery, as you see, was 7 days compared to the remdesivir, and that was statistically significant. And time to recovery, even in sick patients who are on HFNC and NIV, was significantly better in baricitinib. I'll call this as a combination group versus no combination group. It was significantly better in combination group. And improvement in the clinical status at day 15 was 30% higher, but it did not achieve statistical significance. 28-day mortality was, as you see, less, but again, that did not achieve statistical significance. And serious adverse events, surprisingly, was found to be less in baricitinib combination group as opposed to the non-combination group. So this was the key findings of baricitinib. And the new infection risk also was significantly less in the combination group as compared to the remdesivir group. So this was a positive study favoring the use of combination. But for all the listeners, you need to understand this study did not include corticosteroids as a standard of care. So they did not use corticosteroids for patients who were on oxygen. So it was not the standard of care. So if patients was receiving steroids for other reasons like COPD, asthma or any other autoimmune condition, they continued. Otherwise, as a standard of care, steroids was not used. So this study may not hold much of value, because now use of steroids for COVID patients who are on oxygen has become a standard, and that has shown good benefit from recovery trial. So here steroids were not used. So adopting this strategy of using baricitinib in place of steroids appears far-fetched, because baricitinib is a very expensive drug. Because one strip in India costs around 85,000 rupees for 25 tablets. So it's expensive medicine, and now we have reconciled to the benefit of steroids. So although this study has come in now, I think we may not be compelled to use baricitinib, although the findings are very compellingly beneficial. So the key secondary outcomes also were very impressive in this. They looked at ordinal scale 5 and 6, and day 15 improvement was significantly better in the combination group. And the median duration for one ordinal scale improvement also was statistically significant. And new oxygen use was significantly less in the combination group as compared to the remdesivir group. And all these were significant. And the new need for mechanical ventilation or ECMO also significant, which means patients who went on to progress to needing NIV or HFMC was less in combination group. And patients who progressed to needing mechanical ventilation also was significantly less in the combination group. As I said, this is a very compelling study which really raises our enthusiasm to consider usage of this combination. But as I again reiterating, steroids were not used as standard of care. So now with so much progress that has happened in saving lives with the use of steroids after the recovery trial, so we may not be too much excited about using this combination and not using steroids. So I think that's where I would leave it at that. So now I would talk about, so we have spoken about how initial phase we use remdesivir in a timely way. It can significantly prevent progression of the lung injury and possibly save lives. So that's what we have seen. So now let's look into evidence for steroids in preventing lung injury. So I'm only going to talk about one landmark study, and that's what the whole world has subscribed to. This is the recovery study. So this was a big study looking at 11,500 patients, study done in 175 hospitals. This was a six-armed study. So they had six arms where they were testing different drugs and seeing their benefit, and HCQ arm was stopped. So they had 6,425 patients where they looked at the beneficial effect of steroids, and the usual care, the mortality, 28-day mortality in mechanical ventilated was 41%, and someone who was on oxygen, who were not getting steroids, the mortality was 25%, and where there was no oxygen need or anything, the mortality was 13%. So this was the baseline outcome of patients who were not on steroids. But in the group which got steroids of dexamethasone 6 mg per day for 10 days, they found there was 17% reduction in death in patients who were mechanically ventilated. That was statistically significant. In the group who were on oxygen, there was 1/5 reduction in mortality. That was statistically significant. But in the group which were not on any intervention, which were not on oxygen, there was no benefit of steroids. So this is a very important message that steroids had a significant mortality benefit when someone was on oxygen or higher, oxygen, NIV, HFNC. But it did not show any benefit in COVID patients who did not need oxygen. So that is where the listeners have to be very clear. Don't use steroids indiscriminately in patients who are not on oxygen. So that's what this study clearly showed. And the number needed to treat was 8 in mechanical ventilated, and in oxygen it was 25. So if you look at these outcomes, see, 28-day mortality was 21.6 in dexamethasone, 24.6 in usual. That was significant. And when you look at secondary outcomes, the discharge from hospital within 28 days, more number of patients got discharged in the dexamethasone group compared to the usual group. And if you look at the patients needing mechanical ventilation, it was significantly less in dexamethasone group as compared to usual group. And if you see the death, it almost is close to statistical significance. The trends are towards mortality benefit in dexamethasone. And this is a forest plot which clearly tells you that dexamethasone was very beneficial in patients who needed oxygen, who were on invasive mechanical ventilation, but it was not of benefit. It was not beneficial in patients who were not on oxygen. So this is very important message that people should not use steroids in COVID patients who are not on oxygen. This is extremely important for all the listeners to appreciate, because in fact we may be causing harm to these patients if you are giving steroids where they are not on oxygen. So now coming to, is there evidence for tocilizumab, which is an IL-6 receptor, in preventing lung injury? So the evidence for this comes from this study from Italy early on, which came in Lancet, which was tocilizumab in patients with severe COVID, a retrospective cohort study. So here This is an Italian study which studied 544 patients. 179 were in the tocilizumab group, 365 were in the standard. So as you see, the need for mechanical ventilation appeared to be less in tocilizumab, but it did not achieve statistical significance. It did achieve statistical significance once they did a risk adjustment. So as you see, the mortality was less in tocilizumab group as compared to the standard, and the new infection risk was more in tocilizumab. So that was the main grouse against the use of tocilizumab, because most observational studies and trials have shown increased risk of infection when you use tocilizumab. So as I said, the mechanical ventilation need, when they adjusted for age, sex, SOFA and symptom, then there was a reduction in the risk of mechanical ventilation, and that was statistically significant. As you see, confidence interval is 0.4 to 0.9. So, and they did check median IL-6 levels, and the median IL-6 levels in this study was 238.3, which means 25 to 75 fold higher. So this is an important message. The tocilizumab also should not be used indiscriminately. There may be a very small distinct cohort of patients who may benefit from tocilizumab, but this, so I would urge the listeners to only limit the usage to this select group where you may have checked the IL-6 levels, which is at least 75 fold higher, and who have been clinically deteriorating with all the standard therapy that we have subscribed to. And so there was another study which was stopped after recruiting one third of the patients. Then there were series of studies that came on tocilizumab. So there were more than 60,000 COVID publications, and there was no randomized controlled trials which showed a good mortality benefit with this. So one of the studies, the Stop COVID Tocili study. So that was a study which showed there was some mortality benefit. There was reduced risk of death at day 30. So the time to death was reduced, and there was reduced risk of death at day 30. But the confounders was, they were young age patients, were having main patients that were included were young age and with no comorbidities. So Stop COVID Tocili study sort of indicated that there may be some long-term survival benefit. And then COVACTA and EMPACTA came. So COVACTA failed. This was randomized controlled trials. They did fail to achieve any predefined effective thresholds. And day 28, there was no mortality difference, but it did show there was reduction in the hospital length of stay. EMPACTA study showed reduced mechanical ventilation and some reduction in 28-day deaths. But if you look at the confidence interval in EMPACTA study, it's not statistically significant when you look at 28 or 30-day mortality. So that's about tocilizumab. What we can subscribe to see, all the observational studies showed clinical benefit and some mortality benefit, but the randomized controlled trials failed to show any mortality benefit. So what we can summarily say is, now there is a new study called REMAP CAP study, which appears to have positive effect in tocilizumab patients. And there was another recently published article which came in NEJM just around 2 days back, which showed some benefit with use of tocilizumab. So tocilizumab may have a certain role in a very distinctly specific cohort of patients where IL-6 levels is very high, at least 75 fold higher, with the ongoing clinical worsening with whatever standard measures. So these are the group which possibly may benefit. So we need to look into the data of the REMAP CAP study, which would be published anytime, and possibly we can make some logical conclusions. So that is where I would leave the role of tocilizumab in preventing lung injury. So now we look into evidence for mechanical ventilation. What are the strategies that we can adopt in preventing lung injury? So that again came from this study. So where they found, this was a study by Gattinoni, where they showed 50% of the COVID patients had normal compliance. So this was a study done in 150 patients, where they found 50% of the patients had normal compliance, and these patients can distinctly fell into two groups: one with silent hypoxemia, because their tachypneic, their CO2 should be low, and the second group was dyspneic patients who had symptoms and where your CO2 was normal or they had hypercapnia, and these patients were managed with standard ventilatory settings with or without proning. So what the authors subscribe is, the outcome in patients who get ventilated depend on the severity of the viral infection. So if obviously viral infection is severe, it will influence bad outcome. And the time lag between the patients having infection and seeking medical intervention. So if there is a delayed presentation of the hospital, then obviously it would have an adverse effect on influencing their outcome. And most importantly, response of the patient to the infection also becomes important, and how the patient's lungs responds to mechanical ventilation. So these are the four factors which would influence the outcome of the patients who go on a ventilator, and along with it, the physiological reserves of the patient and the comorbidities. So these are the six factors which typically influence whether someone would survive on a ventilator or would they not survive. So based on this, so they did distinctly identify two types of ARDS that these patients develop. So the L type and H type. So the L type ARDS is very easy to remember. L is low elastance and high compliance. And this is a very unique characteristic of COVID that we have seen. And H type is where they have high elastance and low compliance. So, and we have to strategize the ventilatory support understanding these two distinct pathophysiological mechanisms that exist. So whether we are dealing with patients who have high compliance, which we typically see, or we are dealing with a conventional ARDS is one which had low compliance. So in patients with L type where there is high compliance, so obviously we have to ensure that tidal volumes are kept low, and very high PEEP may not be helpful in this category. But in H type where compliance is low, then you can adopt your typical ARDSnet ventilation where you keep a tidal volume of 5 to 6 and high PEEP. And autopsy has shown that the lung weight is low in patients with L type and it is heavy in H type. So when I say H type, where your alveoli are flooded with lot of inflammatory exudate, that's why your lungs become heavy. In L type, it is more of ventilation perfusion mismatch and there is no flooding of the lungs, so they appear to be low. And the L type may not be amenable for recruitability, but the H type, because your alveoli are all flooded with inflammatory exudates, so they are more amenable for recruitable lungs. And it is shown that the L type of ARDS that sets in with COVID is mainly there is absence of hypoxic pulmonary vasoconstriction and there is no effective oxygenated blood entering the circulation. So it's predominantly ventilation perfusion mismatch that happens, and there will be microthrombi formation in this pulmonary venous circulation. And this L type have increased negative intrathoracic pressures, and because of increased tidal volume, so they are more prone for volutroma or ongoing lung injury or self-perpetuating lung injury. And this leads to a distinct type of ARDS called PCD. So patient self-induced lung injury because of the high tidal volumes, and we have clearly understood in ARDS, high tidal volumes is very deleterious. So, and this is the typical CT pictures of L type and the H type. So in L type, it is mainly ventilation perfusion mismatch due to absence of hypoxic pulmonary vasoconstriction, and you have a microthrombi in the pulmonary venous circulation and not enough oxygenated blood entering the venous circulation. H type, it is predominantly the shunt mechanism where your alveoli are not participating in the gas exchange. So there is, these alveoli are really not participating because these are all flooded with your inflammatory exudate. So it's a shunt mechanism which causes hypoxemia in H type. So in L type, if we are using NIV or if you are using HFNC, which typically L type, it is very easy. You have a very good compliant lung, high compliance. It is very important to look at their work of breathing. So if these patients are very tachypneic, it means they are generating huge negative pleural pressures or your transpulmonary pressures are very high, and this leads to PCD or patient self-induced lung injury, self-inflicted lung injury. And sometimes high PEEP may be beneficial in reducing your changes, dynamic changes in the transpulmonary pressure, and pleural pressure is a surrogate marker of transpulmonary pressure. So it has been shown that changes in the esophageal pressure, which is a reflective of transpulmonary pressure, should be around 5 to 10. If it has exceeded 15, more than 15, then they are at an increased risk of PCD. So this is a very important aspect one needs to understand. If patient with COVID with a good compliance, is very tachypneic with increased work of breathing, then we understand that there is huge changes in the pleural pressure. So the huge changes in the pleural pressure indicates the transpulmonary pressures are going high. So once the transpulmonary pressures are going high to more than 15, which means they are at an increased risk of self-perpetuating ARDS or a lung injury, which we call as PCD, patient self-inflicted lung injury. So it is important to notice whether their work of breathing is very high in L type. If it is high, then it means their transpulmonary pressures are going high and there will be worsening of ARDS. If work of breathing is less, then possibly they may not progress to further worsening, and PEEP may have some beneficial effect in circumventing or mitigating the changes in the transpulmonary pressure. So that is a concept that I think one needs to understand. And these patients may not be very responsive to proning. And it is also shown that in the L type, which have high compliance, so these are the patients who have increased risk of this microthrombi formation. And this microthrombi formation is triggered by the cytokine storm. And it is reflected by very high D-dimers in these patients. And these are the patients who would benefit from your anticoagulation. So because we understand very high D-dimer in a L-type ARDS where predominantly ventilation perfusion mismatch is happening, there is extensive microthrombi which they have shown in the autopsy findings. And these are the patients who would benefit. And if their D-dimers are more than tenfold, even there is a reasonable case series have shown role of thrombolysis to circumvent this microthrombi formation. Okay, I think this is something which I want all the trainees to understand. When we ventilate a patient with ARDS, there is this physiological aspect one needs to understand. So there are two distinctive pressure changes that happen in expiration and inspiration. So when we have intubated and ventilated a patient with ARDS in COVID, so during expiration, so it is predominantly the pressure that would influence the transpulmonary pressure is the PEEP. Okay, so here if we say we have given a PEEP of 5, so the transpulmonary pressure in a dependent lung where lung is collapsed is always a bit higher because you see the pleural pressure is high. So the transpulmonary pressure is just a cumulative pressures of alveolar pressure and the pleural pressure. So what happens? The transpulmonary pressure of non-dependent becomes 6, 5, difference between this and this, 5 minus minus, that becomes 6. On the dependent side, the transpulmonary pressure becomes 7. So this is during expiration. So during inspiration, we give pressure support, right? So when we give pressure support, then you have this plus 8 that gets added. So what happens, if you are giving a PEEP of 5 with the airway pressure of 13, so your transpulmonary pressure becomes 15 here during inspiration, and your transpulmonary pressure on the dependent part become 18 because 13 minus minus 5 becomes 18. So what this basically is telling you is there are two differential pressures that happen during expiration and inspiration, and during inspiration, the pressure support that you add in a ventilator has a huge role on influencing the increase in the transpulmonary pressure. So our whole aim is to keep the transpulmonary pressure low so that your risk of volute trauma is mitigated. So this rise, see here there is a differential pressure of 15 and there is an over-distension of non-dependent. On dependent side, there is 18. So this increase, there is over-distension of alveoli which leads to volute trauma. So this physiological aspect one needs to understand when we are setting the ventilation as to how much inspiratory pressure you would keep in during inspiration to limit the volute trauma. So we don't want this to happen. Okay, so what we ideally need is, so that's why we have to look at keeping an optimal PEEP. So suppose you keep a good amount of PEEP during expiration. As you see, the transpulmonary pressure is 16 and 18, so that may be acceptable. But here if you see, what I have done is, you have kept a good PEEP, but you have put the inspiratory pressure very, very low. This is to limit your increase in the tidal volume. So what that does is, so your transpulmonary pressure becomes 19, which is an optimal PEEP here, which has kept the alveoli nice and open. And on the dependent side also, it has kept nice and open, and your transpulmonary pressure is 22. And this is what we need as a lung protective strategy. So for all the listeners, what one needs to understand in COVID is to limit the tidal volume, because you increase the tidal volume, what it means is you are keeping a high inspiratory pressure, so the non-dependent area becomes over-distended and that leads to volute trauma. And we are seeing increasingly patients with COVID ARDS developing barotrauma and mediastinal emphysema because the tidal volumes exceed and they are over-distending the normal alveoli, causing volute trauma. So this is the concept which every trainee has to clearly bear in mind, that there are two distinctly different pressures that act during expiration and inspiration. And summarily, you can sort of conclude PEEP is always beneficial. Please keep a close watch on the volumes that you deliver, because the higher volumes you give, you will cause over-distension in the alveoli that are not affected, leading to barotrauma. So inspiratory pressure is something which we need to keep tweaking to keep, because in our patients, sometimes we don't keep pressure support at all. We keep inspiratory pressure support of even zero because they don't need, because they're generating such a high tidal volume. So this is a concept I want all the listeners to understand. So the recommendations for mechanical ventilation is, obviously it is the standard ARDS recommendation, either volume controlled or pressure controlled could be used, but pressure controlled is more extensively studied in ARDS. Low tidal volume is the way to go, and that gets grade 1B. As in ARDS, we don't want tidal volumes, because high tidal volumes have been time and again found to be deleterious, and so is the case even in COVID patients. Even in L type, we don't want high tidal volume. Even in H type, we just want adequate tidal volume. We don't want high tidal volume. And keep plateau pressure less than 30 cm of water. And PaO2 by FiO2 is less than 200. Use high PEEP if they are recruitable lung. And if PaO2 by FiO2 is 201 to 300, then high PEEP may not be beneficial. So about recruitment, there is no good evidence to say recruitment maneuvers will help in COVID ARDS. But it may be tried if you are dealing with H type of ARDS, which is a conventional ARDS where your compliance is low. But the standard ARDS principles apply to COVID ARDS, but with more emphasis on keeping the tidal volumes in check, because you don't want high volumes, especially in L type where compliance is high. So the take home message, so we have to remember this diagram and see at what time frames would we put the interventions to protect the lungs. So we have understood now there's a good evidence for early use of antivirals to prevent perpetuating worsening of lung injury. And then we know we have good evidence for steroids in preventing further progression of lung injury. And we know that there is a scientific plausibility of using low molecular weight heparins to prevent microthrombi, especially in L type where there is more microthrombi formation that has been identified, where there is huge ventilation perfusion mismatch, and it can be indicated by high D-dimers. And it is very important to understand the sound principles of ventilatory strategies, which is low tidal volume ventilation, maybe early proning, and trying to ascertain and understand the different types of ARDS that may be prevailing, because the ARDS in COVID has been unique in that it shows very good compliance, at least in the L type. So there we have to put lot more vigilance into limiting the tidal volume. So thank you all. So I would end with this quote: a comfort zone is a beautiful place, but nothing ever grows there. So thank you all. So you can visit my website www.drpradeeprangappa.com to rehear to this lecture to gain clarity and insights. Thank you all.